So I just want to mention quickly my local collaborators, Curry Kenning in the Division of Rheumatology, Ivana DiDomenico in Hematology, and Jerry Kaplan over in Pathology. I've also received a lot of help in our department from Boopy, from Dr. Kim, and from my colleagues Kathleen and Judith, and also from Nick. But I've got collaborators all over the U.S. and in Switzerland that have been sending me samples, so the results I'm going to show you appear to apply not to just giant cell arteritis patients in Salt Lake City, but giant cell arteritis patients from across the U.S. and at least in Switzerland. And actually, we also have some collaborators in Spain as well. And so these are some of the people that have been sending me samples to the Blood and Tissue Bank. Also, our former resident, Jason Jones, has been sending me a few samples. So this is Barry Marshall and Robin Warren. They won the Nobel Prize for identifying Helicobacter pylori as the cause for gastric ulcers. Remember, that was a very controversial topic when they first proposed it. And but now it seems that, you know, there may be other systemic diseases, autoimmune diseases, diseases that don't appear to be infectious that may indeed be due to either bacterial or viral causes, or maybe even para-infectious, you know, maybe a result of the body's immune reaction to an infectious agent. MS might be one of those, actually. But then there's also, these are pictures of chlamydia in atherosclerosis, and, you know, that sort of, I don't know that it's been a flash in the pan. There's some people that still believe that chlamydia has something to do with atherosclerosis, but it certainly hasn't panned out like Helicobacter has. Now, the University of Utah is home to the artificial heart. It's home to the knockout mouse. But it's also home to cold fusion. So I hope that Burkholderia turns out to be more like the artificial heart and less like cold fusion. So Lynn Gordon, one of my collaborators, actually had a paper out about 12 years ago where she showed some non-human DNA in biopsy specimens, temporal artery biopsy specimens from patients who had giant cell arteritis. And that kind of got me thinking about giant cell arteritis being an infectious disease, but based on those studies that she did, she wasn't able to ever prove a specific agent was causing the disease or able to culture an agent out of the arteries or anything like that. But that article always intrigued me, and then when we got a gift from a grateful patient to study giant cell arteritis, that seemed to me a topic that we could take up. And so I finally was able to convince some collaborators next door to help me with this project. And if you're interested in trying to find a bacterium in a specimen, but you don't know what bacteria you're looking for, it turns out a good way to find it is to look for the 16S subunit of the ribosome. So bacteria, just like human cells or other animal cells, have ribosomes to make proteins, but there's this 16S subunit that's unique to bacteria that's not found in animal cells. And so if you can search for 16S ribosomal RNA in a sample, because ribosomes, if there are bacteria there, ribosomes are very abundant. There's going to be lots of ribosomal RNA that you can look for. And this little diagram here with the black and white bars, these show variable and conserved regions in the gene, the bacterial gene for the 16S RNA. So you can PCR for the conserved regions, and you will pick up all of the bacteria in your specimen, not just the particular bacteria. So it's a great screening tool to look for that subunit if you're interested in bacteria. So I've presented before about some of the preliminary work we've done with giant cell arteritis and mortality, the accumulation of blood and tissue specimens from my collaborators, finding hepcidin in these specimens, microarray analysis of these specimens, and I'm not going to talk about any of that today in the interest of time. I'm going to go straight to the cool stuff. So we just took 8 of these specimens, 2 control specimens, you know, patients who were biopsied, but whose biopsies turned out to be negative. Those are our controls. And then 6 positive specimens. So these were taken from 5 patients. One of them had a bilateral biopsy. So what you do is you take the specimens, which are preserved in this stuff called RNA later, you extract their DNA, and then you PCR against the conserved regions of that 16S subunit. You clone the resulting fragments into a vector that then multiplies, gives you a bunch of the 16S RNA. You can sequence it, and then you blast it against known bacterial sequences. So there are these huge databases available online of all of, you know, hundreds, maybe thousands of different species of bacteria and their the sequence in their 16S subunit. And you can blast your sequence that you found against these known sequences and see if there's any homology. And there were several sequences that we came up with that had homology with other bacterial species, but the only species where we had 100% homology was this genus Burkholderia, which I'll describe to you in a minute, because probably most of you, like me, had not heard of it before. But to confirm this experiment, we took these same specimens, did the same DNA extraction, but this time we PCR'd against the genes that were specific for Burkholderia. So these are DNA sequences that are unique to Burkholderia. They're not found in any of the other bacteria that have been characterized. These were directly sequenced, and we confirmed Burkholderia sequences in 4 out of our 6 specimens and in neither of the 2 control specimens. So the 2 positive specimens that where we couldn't confirm Burkholderia sequences came from the same patient. That was the patient that had bilateral biopsies. Now, it's possible there's bacteria everywhere, right? And it's possible that there's just dead bacteria somewhere in our operating rooms or on our instruments, or, you know, it's very difficult to keep something completely sterile and clean when you're handling it in the lab and when you're handling it in the operating room. So one thing you can do to convince yourself that these are actually live replicating organisms and not just some dead DNA laying around is to extract RNA and then do reverse PCR, again using genes that are specific to Burkholderia. And again, we were able this time to identify Burkholderia transcripts, so RNA that had been made from DNA, presumably, in 4 out of the same 4 out of 6 specimens and none of the 2 control specimens. So this seemed to be pretty good evidence that our temporal artery biopsies from our affected patients have this bacteria in them. So Burkholderia are aerobic gram-negative rods. They're obligate intracellular pathogens. Most of them cause plant and animal diseases, but there are only 3 that are associated with human disease. Some of you might have heard of Burkholderia sepatia, because it causes pneumonia in CF patients. But the diseases caused by pseudomallei and mallei are mainly seen in other parts of the world, not so much in the United States. And one thing that's interesting about this genus is that, in general, they tend to be very antibiotic resistant and evasive of the host immune system. So patients that have these infections, you have a double the time helping the patient get rid of it. And this brings up another point. So the idea that giant's arteritis might be caused by an infectious disease is not something new, even within the last 10 years. There's people, you know, 50 years ago thought that giant's arteritis could be infectious. And so they would try to gram stain specimens, they would try to culture specimens, they would do electron microscopy, and no one's ever been able to show an infectious organism in these specimens. And that's why the subject was sort of dropped until Lynn Gordon did this study about 12 years ago. And one of the characteristics of this bacteria, I think, explains those initial negative results. Because it's an intracellular pathogen, it's not particularly easy to culture. It's not particularly easy to see, like on gram stain. And I think that may explain why these initial investigations turned up negative and why the whole idea was sort of dropped prematurely. So the species that we were able to subtype using multi-locus sequencing is Burkholderia pseudomallei. It's actually endemic in South Asia and Australia. It's best associated with this disease in that part of the world called amyloidosis, which is characterized by fever, pneumonia, and these lung nodules. Very difficult to treat, highly antibiotic resistant. It can also cause other diseases, which are characterized by cutaneous vasculitis, which is interesting because that's kind of like giant cell arteritis. It, in some cases, can cause a pyogranulomatous vasculitis and a CNS vasculitis. So these are all characteristics that are sort of like, those are sort of at least reminiscent of giant cell arteritis. And this is a very fastidious organism. It has to be grown in selective media to prevent the overgrowth of other flora, which I think explains why, or may explain why, previous researchers weren't able to culture anything out of these arteries. It's because if you don't have your media just right, I mean, it's hard to culture an intracellular pathogen anyway, but if you don't have your media just right, not only will this organism not grow, but all the other contaminants will grow much more quickly and completely overtake the culture. And then you just have a bunch of contaminants. We do have a mouse model of Burkholderia that we've been playing with a little bit over in the next door in the hospital. If you give them too much Burkholderia, it causes an overwhelming sepsis and death. If you give them a little bit less, they get this chronic granulomatous infection. Again, kind of sounds like giant cell arteritis. You can get a pyogranulomatous vasculitis with multinucleated giant cell formation in mice. And these mice seem have a lot of trouble producing immunoglobulins to fight the infection. So there's something funny about this organism that allows it to evade the host immune system. Burkholderia pseudomallei is also considered a potential bioterrorist pathogen because of these characteristics, because your body doesn't seem to be able to fight it off because it's antibiotic resistant. But luckily, we were able to send our specimen. The DOD has a lab in Fort Collins at Colorado State, and we were able to send our specimen over there, and they confirmed that our specimen, or the species that we've come up with in our specimens, does not have the characteristics associated with the bioterrorism ones, and so that was good. So we didn't have our lab, like, you know, raided and you know, taken over by Homeland Security. There is a commercially available monoclonal antibody against the lipopolysaccharide in the cell wall of Burkholderia, and here's one, you know, illustrative example of a control artery and an affected artery. And then there's the immunofluorescence on the right. You can see with the control artery, there is no immunofluorescence, the control specimen, and then very bright immunofluorescence in the affected specimen, showing organisms throughout the specimen. You can also use the same commercially available antibody to detect Burkholderia LPS in the serum of affected patients. So all of our patients, when they get a biopsy in the operating room, we also get a serum sample, and you can then react their serum against this antibody using an ELISA. And so what I have down here are 16 control patients. So these are patients whose biopsies turned out to be negative. We have 29 patients collected from Utah and Spain. All have these very high levels of Burkholderia lipopolysaccharide in their serum. This is just for fun. We took one patient who'd been on steroids, and their serum was still positive for Burkholderia, but it was on the low side compared to the people who had just been freshly biopsied. And then just to compare it to some other rheumatologic diseases, we had 6 rheumatoid arthritis patients, 5 patients that were in the hospital for other unrelated infections, and 12 patients with Takayasu's arteritis, which is a disease in younger people that some people think looks a lot like giant cell arteritis, so we were testing them for fun too, and they seem to be negative for this organism as well. So the data that we have so far is we've identified Burkholderia DNA in these specimens, RNA in our specimens, and we've seen Burkholderia protein in the specimens and in the serum of affected patients. We've since been able to culture the organism out of affected arteries, again, by using selective media. It's one of those things that if you know what organism you want to culture and you do and you make the right conditions in your media, you can culture this organism out of the arteries. We've also taken our species of Burkholderia that's sort of like pseudomallei, and in vitro, we've been able to show that it can activate dendritic cells. And you might remember that those are the little gatekeeper cells outside the adventitia of the artery. And a dendritic cell activation is a critical step in the process of giant cell arteritis. So just from people that know about giant cell arteritis pathogenesis, they know that dendritic cell activation is an important component of that process, and we've been able to show that this bacteria can activate those cells. And also in vitro, we've shown that Burkholderia organisms will cause giant cell formation in a dish. We still don't know what Burkholderia's role is in giant cell arteritis. You know, we can't really fulfill Koch's postulates. I'm not going to drink a beaker full of Burkholderia like Robin Warren did. and a lot of questions remain. Why? I mean, presumably this, we don't know the epidemiology of this organism yet. That's all yet to be determined. But presumably it's out in the environment everywhere, and all of us are exposed to it, and none of us seem to get sick from it. And so why is that? Why is it that there's just a very small number of elderly patients that seem to be susceptible to infection to this organism? Is there some hole in their humoral immunity or in their cellular immunity that allows this bug to evade their immune system? Is there some sort of age-related change in the immune system that allows this organism to be cleared in otherwise younger, healthy people, but in certain older people, they lose their ability to completely clear the organism and get this chronic, you know, kind of walled-off infection? I mean, people with giant cell arteritis are sick, and they have, you know, if you do an autopsy on these people, they have giant cells all over their body, not just in their head and neck. And yet they're not systemically sick usually when they're treated. And but it seems like their immune system is somehow walling off the infection, but just not able to clear it. So after we accumulated these data, we have an IRB protocol approved to put patients with giant cell arteritis on antibiotics. And so far, just here at the U, we've enrolled six of our GCA patients, most of them freshly diagnosed, but a few of them that were either having a relapse or one patient in particular who couldn't be tapered off of steroids. We've given them between 1 to 3 months of either doxycycline or minocycline. The organism we've cultured, at least in vitro, appears to be susceptible to these antibiotics because it lacks some of the type 3 secretion factors that, like, the bioterrorism form of this organism has. All of our patients had to have positive ELISAs for the Burkholderia pseudomallei LPS, and all patients are following a strict taper, at least, you know, this has been going on for about a year, but, you know, some patients have been on this protocol for a month, and some of them have been on it for a year, because we don't have tons of giant cell arteritis patients at one institution, but so far we haven't had any relapses. I can tell you the guy that's been on antibiotics the longest is a patient of Dr. Warner's, who was diagnosed with giant cell arteritis about 2 or 3 years ago, and he's never been able to taper below 17.5 milligrams per day on his prednisone dose. He has horrible osteoporosis. He has 5 compression fractures in his spine. He's completely miserable on steroids. But every time he got tapered below that amount of steroid, his headaches would come back. He'd feel sick. His sed rate would go up. And as of about 2 weeks ago, he's down to 7.5 milligrams per day and feeling good, and his sed rate's staying down, and I'm hoping that I'll be able to get him completely off. I treated him for three months with doxycycline initially, because after the first month his blood was still positive for LPS. It had come down substantially, it had been cut in half, but his blood was still positive. And so I'm not exactly sure what's going to happen to these patients. I don't know if they need to be on chronic antibiotics. I don't know if they'll ever clear the infection. I don't know if they'll require repeated treatment with antibiotics, but at least so far in this small study, they seem to be doing well. This is just a quick list of our support, including our grateful donor, Grace Stillwell, who's up here on the wall up here. She's kind of how it all got started here at Utah anyway. What I envision happening is a multi-center placebo-controlled trial of antibiotics plus steroids. You can't just treat these patients with antibiotics. I don't think that would be safe or ethical. And but I envision people getting randomized to steroids plus placebo or steroids plus antibiotics. It'll have to be multi-center because we just don't see enough giant cell arteritis patients at any single institution to power a study. And then we will look at the relapses and the steroid tapers in the two groups. And I think that is what ultimately will determine whether or not this bacteria is really has anything to do with the pathogenesis of this disease. So thanks very much, and I'd be happy to take questions. Yes.
So I followed this with great interest, and you definitely raised the case.
Right.
Who would be likely to be in some way, very likely to have genetics. So again, I mean, it seems to be an important step, isn't it, to sort of look at some of the clinical trial of how it works.
Yeah, there is, you know, most of my collaborators are NANOS members, and NANOS does have this organization called Nordic, you know, which is supposed to organize multi-center trials like this. And so I talked with Izzy Goldberg about that when he was here, about maybe running the trial through Nordic. I have some concerns because you lose a certain amount of control over how things are done when you let a group like that take over. There's also, you know, there are also similar organizations in rheumatology that could run a trial like this, you know, that already have multi-center trials up and running. And you know, we have the same concerns about those organizations. We worry about losing control over a trial. So I haven't, I honestly haven't decided what to do next.
So, and one other related, kind of in the pantheon of these diseases, when you walk into giant cell arteritis, temporal arteritis, and all the mountains of the matter,
right. Yeah, that's, you know, Curry has tested some of his PMR patients, and just in a small sample, they've all been negative, at least in terms of their ELISA. But, you know, some people with PMR do go on to develop GCA, and I think you'd have to test a large cohort of those patients before you could definitively say whether or not some of them are infected or get infected or, yeah. But, there probably is some relationship with that disease. You know, in the same protocol, not the same bacteria, but that same, you know, you're looking at the 16S ribosomal RNA, that can be used in other diseases like Wegener's granulomatosis or sarcoid or some of these, some of the uveitides even, you know, that Dr. Vitale deals with, you know, might also be associated with bacterial pathogens, and we could use the same protocol to find other bacterial causes. Yeah, Nick? Yeah, I'm not, I mean, I guess that's sort of a chicken and an egg thing, like maybe the arteriosclerosis is caused by the inflammation in the artery, or maybe arteriosclerosis makes it easier for the bacteria to wall itself off and protect itself from the immune system.
Or maybe arteriosclerotic changes you see allow the bacteria to
Right, or maybe there's some adhesion molecule in the plaque that allows the bacteria to latch. Yeah, so. Yeah, but presumably, you know, some of the control patients are too. The patients we do biopsy would turn out to be negative. Okay, so these data and some additional data, which I haven't presented, were submitted to Science over the summer, and they said it wasn't novel enough, sent it back. And so then it was submitted to Nature Medicine, and they sent back this huge review. And, you know, they had several concerns. They wanted to see some more numbers. They wanted to know if the investigators who actually did the ELISAs and the immunohistochemistry were masked to the disease status of the patient, of the specimen. And and they wanted to see more with the mouse model. Those were the big concerns. We did put together an R01 that will be reviewed at the NEI this month, so I don't have any feedback from that yet either. Also, the hepcidin data, which I did not present today, but what I presented at this, to this group previously, those were in the paper, and they didn't like that. They wanted that chopped out. And so we're going to try to, they didn't reject the paper, so we're going to try to address their concerns and resubmit to Nature Medicine. Yeah, Bala. No, the ELISAs are reduced. So, they don't get reduced to the point where they're, in the normal range, but they're reduced, maybe 50%, 60% compared to their baseline. So they still presumably are infected. You can't get rid of the bug with antibiotics alone. The body has to participate. And they get better. Yeah. Right. It is, and I think it's differences in different people's immune systems. Is ultimately, I think it would be the answer. Dr. Moran. That's right. Yeah. Yeah, there's clearly a genetic predisposition to the disease. You don't see it in African Americans, you don't see it in Latinos, you don't see it in Asians. It is a Caucasian disease, and that makes me think that there is some immune system defect that's inherited or heritable that has something to do with your inability to fight off this particular bacterial species. Yeah, Bryce. Well, Greg wants to study that, and it'd be easy enough for me to get him some specimens and see. Yeah, sure.
I mean, there's some populations that are totally different. You can't find any of that. Easter Island,
right. And none of them have. Yeah, no, there might be. That's something I would like to work on with Greg. Yeah. Bryce. Yeah, no, that's absolutely true. The only thing we have is we do have a biomarker. We do have the serum ELISA, and if we can show that the amount of LPS goes down with antibiotic treatment consistently in treated patients, that shows that the antibiotic effect is at least in part responsible for the therapeutic effect. But you're right, we can't say that it's entirely responsible. Yes, in the back. Right. No, that was proposed in our R01 submission, to look at, to see if that has anything to do with the hole in the immune system. But I think that's going to turn out to be like a related factor. I'll bet that HLA locus is somewhere near another locus that actually has to do with disease susceptibility. I don't know that HLA subtype actually is what causes the disease, but I'll bet you it's related somehow. Yes. Oh. Yeah, no, you're definitely right, and I'm sure it has something to do with disease pathogenesis, but we don't know what it is yet. Yeah. Yeah, you bet. And I think it's this ELISA, the serum ELISA test. You know, I hope, you know, that's another thing that I hope to do with this multi-center trial is to prove that this blood test is just as good as a biopsy. It would save a lot of unnecessary biopsies. It allow for quicker diagnosis and quicker treatment. Absolutely. Yeah. Great question. Thank you. All right. Thanks very much.